Okay, so I am going to go ahead and get us started. Welcome, everyone. My name is Brittany Anderson Martin, and I am so thankful to have you all here. So, if you don't know, the title of this webinar is Elevating Excellence, and we are going to be exploring NCWIT's Collegiate Aspirations and Community Aspirations and Computing Community. So thank you so much for joining us today. We are so excited to bring you this conversation. I feel very confident that you will find a ton of value in it. So today we're going to explore NCWIT's Aspirations and Computing Community. As I mentioned, we're going to hear from current AIC community members, both in college and those who have graduated from their post-secondary programs and moved into the workforce. And we're also going to hear from some collegiate faculty on the specific strategies that they have used to support, empower, and just be there for women, genderqueer, and non-binary technologists as they are pursuing their technical and degree programs. So thank you all for being here today. I am going to pass it to Stephanie, but I just want to say that we're going to hear a lot from our panelists today. And while all of our participants, you won't be able to come off camera or come off of mute, we do invite you to share your name, your state, and maybe a reason why you decided to join today's webinar in the chat so that we can hear from you in the chat. And so now I'm going to pass it to Stephanie to go ahead and tell us a little bit about NCWIT.
Thank you so much, Brittany, and thank you all for being here today. The National Center for Women in Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,600 universities, companies, nonprofits, government organizations nationwide that convene, equip, and unite change leader organizations to increase the influential and meaningful participation of girls and women at the intersections of race, ethnicity, class, age, gender identity, sexual orientation, disability status, and other historically marginalized identities. And this is all in the field of computing, particularly in terms of innovation and development. And this webinar today wouldn't be possible without our sponsors, which are the DoD STEM, Department of Defense STEM. DoD STEM is the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students, and many career development opportunities for educators. We will share their website in the chat for you to learn more. And with that, Brittany, I will let you take it over.
Perfect. So I am going to start with talking about NCWIT's Aspirations in Computing Community. So NCWIT has a tagline, and it is "Inclusion changes what's possible." And that's really evident in the spirit of the Aspirations in Computing program. Since 2007, AIC Aspirations in Computing has increased persistence in computing through continuous engagement and ongoing encouragement at each pivotal stage of individuals' education and professional development. As Stephanie mentioned, we work across the entire, technical ecosystem. And so we, as it, the Aspirations in Computing community works to inspire, encourage, and advance women, genderqueer, and non-binary students from kindergarten all the way through career into programs that spark an early interest in computing, and then recognize and celebrate the technical aspirations and abilities of women, genderqueer, and non-binary individuals. And finally, a key aspect of the AIC community is creating a sense of connectedness and belonging for individuals who are pursuing their computing and technology, careers or educations and degrees. So through the early cultivation of these skills and interests and ongoing recognition and AIC's very supportive community, NCWIT is changing lives and revolutionizing the face of technology. So AIC has several interconnected program elements that are supported by volunteers, partner organizations, companies, and institutions. The elements are the award recognitions, which are probably what most of you are familiar with. It's kind of the, you know, NCWIT's big draw. But there's also the AiC Community, Tecnologicas, and AspireIT. And we're going to cover a little bit of all of those today. So the award recognitions recognizes elements of your aspirations and ability, both technical and leadership in both high school and at the collegiate level, as well as recognizing the educators who support those individuals in their technical pursuits. The Aspirations in Computing community reaches over 4,000 high school students, over 2,000 high school educators, and over 300 collegiate students every single year as a part of both the award and also the community. AiC started as a community for high school students and high school award recipients specifically, and it has now expanded into just this vast network of technologists who are supporting each other, and they are supported by NCWIT's partners, alliance members, and again, in K-12, in higher education, in the workforce, if you look around, NCWIT is there working to build more inclusive spaces for diverse individuals in computing and technology. Next, we have the Tecnologicas program. That is a very special initiative of NCWIT and the Televisa Foundation that was designed to raise awareness among young Latinas and their families about their opportunities and about careers in technology and computing. So Tecnologicas uses the very powerful stories of Latina women and genderqueer non-binary individuals who are working in technology fields and recognizes the power of innovation to change the world. These stories are shared via Televisa, you know, different media campaigns, social media campaigns, and they allow girls that look like these are Tecnologicas ambassadors to see and relate to real life role models. And that's very important. Finally, the AspireIT program sparks an interest in computing through K-12 computing programs and peer-to-peer learning. There is a toolkit that anyone can use to help them bring their ideas to life and to bring computing experiences to underrepresented K-12 youth. And then the AspireIT Impact Award recognizes our community members who are going above and beyond in creating those experiences and making a difference in their communities. So I invite you to check out aspirations.org and ncwit.org to learn more about these programs because they are so vast and so just critical to our community and our shared efforts. As mentioned, AiC touches thousands of individuals every year. And what has come from that is just a huge network of over 22,000 women, genderqueer, non-binary technologists. You can join as early as the ninth grade and all the way into early the early technical workforce. As of the latest AiC survey, about 50% of the AiC members are in college, 30% are in high school, and 5% are in graduate school. So, and the last 15% are in the workforce. So, regardless of what level you are at in your technical journey, technical and computing journey, you will find community within Aspirations in Computing. So the power of this community cannot be understated. The data shows NCWIT data, because everything that NCWIT does is evidence and research based. And the data shows that the going from high school to post-secondary education, 90% of AiC participants persist in STEM and 82% persist in computing, which is an outrageous retention number. If you are like us and love to look at those statistics. Going over benefits, there are a number of reasons that one would want to join the AiC community. First, there are private, I'd like to say exclusive, invitations to virtual and in-person meetups. There is visibility for your technical achievements. This is a national community and a national award. And so it has that name recognition. And, you know, people know about this work. And if you're involved in that, then by proxy, your excellence in this work. There are computing outreach opportunities. As mentioned, there's a workforce alliance within NCWIT. And every year there is a virtual career fair where, you know, our community members are able to have individual conversations with hiring leaders from, you know, companies like Apple and Google and Microsoft and just all of our partners that you can find listed on ncwit.org. You get an opportunity to network with your peers and corporate workforce members. It cannot be overstated that the Aspirations in Computing community is a community. There is a deliberate and intentional effort to make sure that there are opportunities for folks to come together, learn from each other, unite, and then be equipped as they go out into the world and then bring hopefully more AiC community members in. The Aspirations in Computing community also gets exclusive access to scholarships, internships, job opportunities, and more from both of the Workforce Alliance and NCWIT's Academic Alliance. And most importantly, this community helps foster a sense of belonging and persistence in the computing and technology field. So moving on. There are also a number of opportunities. So we offer skill building workshops through AiC Labs where you can, you know, beef up your technical skills, mentoring with NCWIT workforce members through AiC Connections, which is a formal mentoring program where you are assigned a technical mentor working in some capacity through one of our Workforce Alliance partners. Exclusive eligibility to apply for awards such as the Collegiate Award or the Impact Award. And I'm just saying the awards come with money and recognition. So that in and of itself is just a huge benefit. You get an opportunity to be a spokesperson to young people who may not see themselves in computing and technology or may not know the opportunities and, you know, just an opportunity to elevate a platform for what matters to you. And then there's also the opportunity to be a AiC campus rep and spread the word about the Aspirations in Computing community in your at your school, on your campus, and then build community with people in person and online in our digital spaces. Our digital spaces include a Slack workspace, a private Facebook group, and a LinkedIn group. So whatever platforms you're on, we are probably there. Our Slack channels range from job search advice to mental health discussions, and there are a number of interest groups and various opportunity channels for you to engage in. And once you join the community, you can be invited to join each of these spaces, and all opportunities and events for Aspirations in Computing are shared on the opportunities page, as well as in the community newsletter and in social spaces. I'm going to briefly touch on the Aspirations in Computing Collegiate Award because that is a critical component of the AiC community, but as you can see, the community far goes beyond that. So the Collegiate Award honors the outstanding computing accomplishments of undergraduate and graduate women, genderqueer, and non-binary individuals. It recognizes technical contributions to projects that demonstrate a high level of innovation and potential impact. Past projects have included software and app developments, machine learning, big data, bioinformatics, cybersecurity, space, and so much more. You'd probably be surprised to know that you know a number of national winners already because they go on to do big and bad things. Like if you've seen the film Coded Bias on Netflix, that features an AiC Community Award winner. So applications for the AiC community do open, or the AiC award, not community, the AiC award open up on October 10th, and the application will close on November 20th. So if you are doing some sort of technical work or working on a technical project on your campus, please feel encouraged to apply and share your work with us. So why should you apply? So we want you to apply because we want to showcase your work, number one. Like, you're doing something amazing. We want to amplify that. There is a multi-tiered award structure that includes winners, honorable mentions, and finalists. Winners receive $10,000 and a trophy, national winners. Honorable mentions receive $2,500 and a trophy, and finalists receive $100. So there's a cash prize for every level of the national award. There's also state and regional awards that, you know, our local affiliates also can like to share and recognize folks for. Recipients also receive swag and opportunities to network with our award sponsors, namely Amazon and Qualcomm. So very, very large companies that you get the opportunity to have like intimate conversations with and build relationships with and build that social capital. By completing the application, the community application is a great way for you to practice for grant or report writing at school and to apply for graduate school. Just a fun little quote, one of our 2022 recipients said, "It was so fun and exciting to make a video showcasing my project. I really love the application process and it helped me to write my research paper." One of the highest outcomes that we see within AiC is just that increase in confidence and skill so that when you enter the workforce, especially from the collegiate community, you go in at a level that is different than those who have not participated in programs such as these. So by now, I hope that you agree with me and recognize all of the ways that the AiC community and award can contribute to your collegiate experience. The community is open again to all women, genderqueer, non-binary students in high school, college, or at the graduate level, as well as to all Tecnologicas ambassadors. At the collegiate level, the community is open to the same individuals. You just must be enrolled in a post-secondary institution like a community college or university with a major or a minor in computing or an engineering related community or discipline. Sorry. And so my last slide before we get to the conversation is to join this community is very, very easy. It takes just a couple of minutes. You first register for an AiC community account on aspirations.org and you select whatever pathway is applicable to you, whether it's collegiate or whether it's high school. You should complete your account profile and then submit your brief and free community membership form. Membership is absolutely free. And we only ask for your college and university and what your major and minor is. So it's two questions, just pass that along. And then once you're approved, you will come subscribe to AIC's newsletter and also invited to connect and join the other online spaces and resources. And you get to choose which ones you opt into. For faculty and staff on the call today, I want to encourage the women, genderqueer, and non-binary individuals that are in your computing and technical classrooms to join the AiC community. It's very important for folks to receive that direct individual encouragement. So, you know, going up and saying, you know, "Hey, Sally Sue, I think that you should join this community because it would be a really good opportunity for you." To further drive home the impact of participating in AiC, I am super excited to help moderate this panel that will feature four AiC community members and also a very, very dedicated and engaged volunteer and faculty member. So we're going to take a moment to greet our guests. Panelists, if you can come on camera, I'm going to start with Meghan Flynn. Meghan, if you'd like to take a moment to introduce yourself, go right ahead.
Absolutely. Hi, everyone. My name is Meghan Flynn. I just recently graduated from the New Jersey Institute of Technology with a bachelor's in computer science. And I'm currently a software engineer within the technology analyst program at Bank of America. Really excited to be here. Glad to be here. And a few fun things about me that I can just share really quickly is that I love thrifting, reading, and taking care of my plants. I have so many around me right now. They're all inside because it's absolutely pouring rain outside and they'd get damaged. But I've been a member since my senior year of high school when I won the national award. And yeah, that's it for me. If you can hear the thunder, that's a thunder.
Thank you, Meghan. I love thunder, so I would love to hear it in the background. Okay, next we are going to have Valencia Coleman go ahead and introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. My name is Valencia. I am a gameplay engineer at Alchemy Labs, which is a game studio that does VR games. And I've been part of the AiC community since I was in high school, to the point I don't remember. I was undergrad. So I graduated my undergrad degree in 2020, and I currently work on my master's degree. So I'm still somewhat in the collegiate field. And my favorite memory from being part of this community was actually winning one of the awards and going to Georgia Tech and getting some swag and having such a good time. It was my first time really going to Atlanta. So I really, really enjoyed it. It was amazing. And things I do outside of my computing is I like writing. I like playing video games because my career is in games, but I still like playing them. And I also love to anime conventions because I love anime. And that's me.
Thank you, Valencia. I love that. Okay, next we are going to hear from Vonesha Shaik.
Hi, everyone. My name is Vonesha. I'm a third year CS major at Georgia Tech. I'm focusing on intelligence, AI, ML. I've been a part of NCWIT and AIC since 2019. When I won a National Honorable Mention Award in high school. And when I'm not coding and with my mouse and monitor, I like to read. I do a lot of cooking and I like to explore new foods. And I'm very involved with on-campus initiatives to bring CS opportunities at the collegiate level. That's a little bit about me and I'm really excited to speak to everyone today.
Thank you, Vonesha. Okay, and our last AIC community member will be Sarah Olson.
Hi, my name is Sarah. I'm a third year studying computer science, pursuing both a Bachelor of Science and a Master of Science at Worcester Polytechnic Institute. I've been a member of AIC since February 2021 after winning Massachusetts Affiliate Honorable Mention. Some hobbies I have outside of computing are video editing. I'm a storyteller at heart, so I love sharing stories through video. I also love anything to do with aviation. I love planes, and yeah, that's pretty much a little bit about me.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Okay, and last but certainly not least, we're going to hear from Dr. Alan Jamieson, who is our faculty representative.
Hi, y'all. My name is Alan Jamieson. I currently serve as the Director of Computing Programs and Teaching Professor for Corey College at the Rue Institute of Northeastern University in Portland, Maine. I've been part of the community since, I think, 2012. This was a very difficult question because I had to really search my memory to figure out exactly when I started working with NCWIT. But the Aspirations program has meant a lot to me, and I've spent a lot of time with the Aspirations program just because of the tremendous work that these folks are doing, and it's unbelievable, and you can get a lot out of it, and I think we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Outside of teaching, mentoring, doing administrative stuff, sifting through 5 million emails every single week. I love to cook. I cook all sorts of different cuisines. And since moving to Maine a few years ago, just really leaning into sort of the outdoor activity that Maine allows for.
Beautiful. I've never been to Maine, but I've heard.
Oh, you should come. Not during winter, though.
So I am going to stop sharing so that we can see everyone and kick us off with some questions. While I have some questions prepared, we really do want to hear from you, our attendees and participants. So please feel free to begin sharing your questions using the Q&A feature. We will answer as many as we can. I am going to start with the first question and ask all of the Aspirations in Computing panelist community members to answer it. So we'll start with probably Meghan. Tell us about your experience as a member of the Aspirations in Computing community. What are some cool perks that you've enjoyed being a part of it?
So I think you touched on a lot of them in the presentation, but I will reiterate that the amount of opportunities that you get to be part of such a supportive community is like really off the charts. To name a few things that I know I've done personally, sometimes within like the Slack group or even on Facebook, people who are doing really interesting research will ask for people to participate in it if we're part of that specific focus group. So I know I've participated in other really awesome research, and there's usually gift cards surrounding that, even though it's not an NCWIT program. And I've met so many people who are part of the community just like through mutual affiliations, whether it be if I'm at a conference or just out like at a university event. It's like, you know, you just get to talk and meet other people. So I think that's been a really big benefit for me to know that like I have someone
so Meghan in a storm. So she might have be experiencing some technical difficulties. So I'm going to shift to Sarah.
So for me, the biggest perk was having the opportunity to go to all of these, you know, like women in tech or diversity in computing conferences. What really was a big life changer for me was going to the Harvard WeCode conference, which is a student run women in tech conference. It's like an hour away from me in Boston. And like, I know it sounds like cheesy, but going there really changed my outlook on my ability to succeed in a tech or computing field. Just because you're surrounded by so many different people who've had, you know, different backgrounds and different paths to get to where they want to be. It was really inspiring for me as someone who doesn't necessarily have a typical career goal in mind to really feel like what I want to do is possible. And most importantly, that I have the backing of people to support me if I need it.
Thanks, Sarah. Vonesha, would you like to contribute?
Yeah, NCWIT has provided so many opportunities to me. It's definitely been a very transformative journey for me with NCWIT. I've had a lot of opportunities to work on projects and research that align with my interests. I really enjoyed all the mentorship programs I got to be a part of. And just being a part of this really energizing community is the biggest perk. I've been able to surround myself with like-minded individuals who share my passion for technology, while also being given a platform to bring change through, I was given resources to be able to host workshops and start a nonprofit. And it's a pretty unique experience that I have here. So over the years, this community has served as a reminder to me that we're not alone on this journey. And there's so many people here to advocate for you and help you reach and achieve for whatever you want to achieve in STEM. And I think that's one of the coolest things about this community.
Thank you so much. I really want to hear more about this nonprofit later on in this conversation for sure. Okay, and last, Valencia, how about you? What has your experience being a member of the Aspirations community been like?
Well, to echo everyone else, it's very similar. So I'll put a little personal twist on mine. I'm from a very small town in Alabama, and I was from a very small area who did not have computing anything. So NCWIT was the first organization that I ever met just looking through online, desperately looking for a scholarship that gave me the opportunity, not only, you know, some scholarships, but it also gave me the opportunity to meet other women that were in computing. Because from where I came from, A, I was wanting to be a woman in games, and B, I was also in wanting to be in video games. So they were just like, what are you talking about? So me talking to NCWIT made me feel that support system. And to anyone who's in that similar situation, NCWIT helped a lot. You guys are my first awards. You guys are the first community I've ever been part of. So it means a lot that I'm still here, and all the benefits and workshops and surveys and everything I've been able to help with NCWIT means a lot. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Valencia. Okay, so I want to shift and hear from you, Alan, just as faculty, really quick, your experience being an award reviewer, but also a mentor to the folks on your campus, and how you leverage NCWIT for that.
Yeah, so like I said in sort of my opening, the Aspirations Award has meant a lot to me because I get to see all of the work that you all are doing. And I am constantly impressed and constantly surprised by the depth and the level, both when we're talking about the traditional Aspirations award winner, awardees in sort of the ninth through 12th, and then also in the Collegiate Award. Within the Collegiate Award, we have sort of multiple tiers when we think about sort of first and second year, junior and senior, and then into graduate school. And just seeing the stuff that everyone's doing, that thinking back as a grad student or as an undergrad or as a high school student, I could never have imagined doing those sort of things myself. That is just such an inspiration to me to sort of keep going, to continue to try to mentor and push forward in these ways. Within sort of the traditional classroom, it is about sort of trying to shift the dynamic, to try to reach a point of parity in the classrooms. And that's a lot about introducing supports to students that are from historically marginalized groups, women, non-binary, genderqueer, very specifically. And NCWIT is a really great resource for me as a faculty member, because I can say, hey, look at this great community that already exists. It's not just at the campus. It's not just me or my fellow faculty members that are telling you that you can do this. Look at this broad community of folks who are doing this, who are all supporting each other. Rely on them, rely on the resources that are out there. NCWIT, from a sort of a faculty perspective and an administrator perspective, NCWIT provides so many resources for being able to change the dynamics within a classroom that I have found very, very valuable over a decade of looking at the resources that are out there.
Thanks, Alan. So next, we are going to shift back to our AIC community members. And we have a question from the audience that kind of ties to one of the questions that I also prepared. So I'm going to merge the two of them. Being a part of the AIC community clearly influenced your tech journey. I'd like for you to share how it made an impact and shaped your experience in the world of computing and technology. Specifically, could you share what type of projects and initiatives you worked on? If I can narrow it down just a little bit more, this is specifically in college. So from the AIC community, if you can share just some examples of, you know, some of the projects that you had. You don't have to go into too much detail, but just, you know, pick the cool ones. We're going to start with Vonesha.
Yeah, absolutely. So being a part of the Aspirations and computing community has had a really profound impact on my technical journey. It's helped me discover like what I'm interested in, and really made me feel like I belong here as well in technology, and that it's something that I can pursue. So speaking more specifically to technical projects that I've done, I've gotten to take part in a lot of research projects here. So one project that was really cool that I got to be a part of is global health device innovation, where I got to research on creating devices for pathology, for creating digital pathology in countries that don't have access to pathology. So that was a really cool project. I've also been interning at Bloomberg for the past 4 years. So in high school, I was able to get an internship and I've been working there in college as well. So I've gotten to work on some really cool technical projects there. And it was something that I was able to reach for and even apply for because of NCWIT and because of the experience, those explorations, and like the confidence I've gained through this organization as well. So I've been able to reach for many, many opportunities here, and the mentorship programs have been so beneficial in helping me shape what I see my future to be. And there's such a great support network here, always here to like cheer you on and help you find resources. So those are some of the projects. I'm always happy to talk about more if you'd like to hear more, but yeah.
Thank you so much. Okay, let's move to Sarah. What about you? What are some projects or initiatives that you thought were really special?
So I will just start by saying that I'm really interested in pursuing, like, improving the accessibility of education. I'm dyslexic myself and come from a family of dyslexics. And a lot of the specialized help is really locked behind huge paywalls. So I hope that in the future that I will be able to, you know, create solutions and tools that can at least, you know, be at least 50% effective, you know. But a lot of the research that is involved in doing that is kind of, again, behind really tightly closed doors. So right now what I'm focused on is getting the skills and building the skills in order to make those things happen. So right now I'm part of a program called CS Access, which is in combination with the Computer Science Teachers Association to improve the accessibility of computer science specific curricula and things of that nature. As far as fun projects, the coolest project I have is this thing called Diver Track, which I was a springboard diver in high school. And Diver Track is just a tool to help high school springboard divers, you know, keep track of their qualifications for state and sectional meets, since all of the qualifications are really confusing, you know, just to have it all in one place.
This conversation, we're going to be doing a series of webinars where we're exploring the intersection of computer science with just various industries. And as you all are talking, I'm hearing healthcare, I'm hearing sports, I'm hearing video games. Like, this is an amazing conversation, nonprofit. Like, I really appreciate this. So I'm going to pass the mic to Meghan to share.
Thanks. So sorry I cut out. Like, I think the thunderstorm has now passed me, so fingers crossed everything is stable. So I'd say a really interesting technical project was one that I actually did kind of like in my award year, you know, coming off of that high. I'm just like, okay, you know, I got this award, I should keep going and doing fun things. So at that time, I know I was really active and like looking at every post in that Facebook group, and one of the things that someone had shared was a CodePath Android course. So CodePath, I feel like, has grown a lot in the past 4 years, or five-ish years, however you want to talk about their journey with mine. But I was able to, just outside of my regular coursework at NJIT, just take this, I think it was a six-week class, at that point in time, to just explore app development, which is something that I had never done before. So at that time, I did it in Java, and I was literally like a freshman in college, up until 3 o'clock in the morning, trying to figure out why my code wasn't working on this Android Studios, which was a platform I'd never used before. My laptop was like, fans were going constantly, just stress all around. But it was a really, really incredible experience that I got through the NCWIT community to challenge myself outside of like my regular like general education courses. And it really came full circle because CodePath actually came to my university like the next year. And so as a senior, I was able to retake a similar course that was adapted for the university in a different language, and improve the ways that I did those projects. Some of them were the same, but a few were different. So I'd say that that was a really amazing time to just see how far I've come and how much I still have to learn.
Thank you. Valencia, what about you?
One's project that is very near and dear to my heart is actually the project I used to apply for an NCWIT award, and it's called Teaching Computational Thinking Skills Using an Augmented Reality Game. And it was my first time using the Unity engine to build a video game, because I'm always trying to mix academia and gaming. I feel like those get mixed a lot, and that's one of my passions, is to mix that. And so what I did was, first time working on Unity engine, it was very stressful because I was like a sophomore, probably early freshman. And I was like, I don't know how any of this works. I'm working in a totally different engine, and it's not many people in my school that can help because the game track is very, very small. So I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. So I always looked at NCWIT and looked at how people did the other codes, and I was able to translate some of it into my code. And it was very, very useful and helpful. And I was able to apply with it. And it was a very cool project because I was actually able to go to a local school and able to show some of the kids my game of how useful it was that they can learn computational thinking skills without, you know, all this going through whole slides and stuff. They're learning through playing a game, which is something I'm very, very passionate about.
Thanks, Valencia. That's really, really creative. Okay, I'm going to shift topics a little bit and go to Alan with this question. How do you bring the Aspirations community and the Aspirations award into your classroom to spread the word and encourage students to get involved? And I will say into your classroom, but I also want to say onto your campus, into your university.
It's a great question. So some of it is just kind of the normal advertising. Hey, you know, there's this award that's available for you. You know, it could be talking to a particular like Women in Computing Club, an ACMW chapter, something of that nature. Those sort of kind of standard type advertising. But also what I've done sort of in the past is, especially in some of my upper level undergraduate courses that I've taught in the past, is bring some of the examples that I've seen of award winners and say, hey, like, look at this, think about this particular topic, think about this particular task, this particular project, how would you go about doing it? And oh, by the way, this was an award winner for the Aspirations program. And let me tell you a little bit about the Aspirations program. So providing a little bit of injecting some of the inspiration that I get from reading all of the applications into the classroom. I think that's very, very valuable, especially as some students, especially in the undergraduate context, think about research and say, oh, research is not something that's accessible to me. I wanted very, very specifically to sort of bring the idea of research into the undergraduate classroom. And I spent a lot of time working on that very specifically and opening those doors for students. And the Aspirations Award was a way for me to sort of inspire students to say, hey, you can do this. But it's also just the general kind of like, hey, like, this is a cool application. This is a cool opportunity for you. Think about taking your project and applying for this award. As Brittany noted, it's money, right? Like, go get some money, right?
Go get that money. Yes. Okay. And so for my collegiate and workforce AIC community members, I want you to tap into that imagination. And I want you to imagine a faculty member is tuning in. And they want to provide the best support for the students in their tech endeavors. And students like you, what is one piece of advice you'd give them based on your journey thus far? Faculty. We're going to start with Valencia.
I guess I can go. My faculty that when I was in college is very, very important to me. She was an amazing faculty member because not only did she focused on like what I want to do. She really dived into what I wanted to do. She was like, okay, you want to do games. Even though our department's small, let me go do some research for you. Let me go talk to NCWIT. She was part of NCWIT. She was like, let me go figure out what this is because I want to find out what your special is. So one piece of advice I get to faculty is let them explore. If they say something specific, maybe help them guide in that direction. Maybe talk Liam Stone they can talk to. Liam different groups that can join. That's the best thing that happened to me as an undergrad, and I just highly recommend any faculty do that same.
Thanks, Valencia. Let's move on to Sarah.
So for me, the most helpful thing that a faculty member ever told me was that, you know, don't take every single first no as an end-all be-all. Like, kind of question some of the no's that you get. For example, like, I'm pursuing BSMS in 4 years. A lot of, like, those first no's would be, oh, you can't register for this class, it's full. Oh, you can't do this, there's a time conflict. Oh, you know, you can't sign up for this class because you really should have this class first. And my advisor was someone who said, you know, you can get into those classes. There may be another way that you have to do it. You know, maybe you have to do it as an independent study, or you can just go up to the teacher and ask if they can get you in the class. But the first no usually isn't the last one. So being being firm and asking, is there another way? No, it's not possible isn't no, it's never possible, is what I would say.
I love that persistence and seeking, you know, yeah, I love that. Okay, so I want to pass the mic to Vonesha. What is one piece of advice you'd give to your faculty?
Yeah, so based off of my experience, I think that lots of women, non-binary students, especially those from underrepresented groups, it's easy to internalize stereotypes and feel like a failure in STEM feels like means that you don't belong. So I think integrating this into curriculums is super, super helpful. And this can be like helping students see themselves succeeding by bringing in diverse role models and mentors into the curriculum. And this can be coming from you, or maybe having like a monthly mentorship coffee chat is something that I've seen that's a super cool program that some professors run, where they connect students with their connections and people who may have faced similar challenges. But I think bringing in those opportunities to connect students to professionals who have faced similar challenges can enhance feelings of belongingness and support, and also create an environment that's failure safe. And it's also a really, really great way to have good mentorship connections, and students can see real people who've been where they've been. And I think that really helps for students to help them thrive and persevere through their pursuits in STEM.
Thanks, Vonesha. And Meghan, what about you?
So I mean, this is probably more than one piece of advice. But for faculty, I feel like getting your students connected, like we've been talking about, to all these different opportunities. I was really lucky to go to a smaller university and have a pretty tiny class size, especially within the honors cohort. But one thing that a history professor did for her class, which was really amazing, was at the beginning kind of, you know, give us like little index cards, like we were like in grade school, and ask us like, you know, how do you pronounce your name? What are your interests? Like, what's something that you want to share with the class, or what's something you're excited about? And that kind of, you know, put me in the mindset of like, okay, you know, she cares. That's really nice. You know, I really appreciate that. It was kind of like a good, really nice welcome to the classroom kind of thing. But even more than that, like, once you have that connection with a student, or, you know, whoever you might connect with, like as faculty, if it's like a similar professional interest or research interest, you can share those opportunities and also share opportunities for students to give back. So I know that at NJIT, the professor that's really connected with the NCWIT community, he kind of leveraged his connection with the Women in Computing Club so that people who are looking for volunteering hours were able to be reviewers for the NCWIT Aspirations Award. So that was a way that he was bringing aspirations to our community. And I saw that and I'm like, that's great. Like, I never would have thought of that. And so it was like approved by the Honors College and people who like gave credit. So it was a really amazing way to bring everyone into this community in a way that students gained something that they needed out of the experience and also were able to connect with others with.
Thank you so much. And yes, we definitely leverage folks for reviewing and helping us to decide those winners, especially at the high school level, maybe if you're still in college, not at the collegiate level yet. So we're coming up on time. I have a couple more questions. The first one is this program is all about your aspirations, right? I want to hear from you. Where are you going? Where is your career going to take you? Where do you imagine it will take you? And how do you imagine that NCWIT and the Aspirations and Computing community will continue to play a role as you advance? We will start with Vonesha.
Yeah, so as someone who's deeply passionate about bridging the gender gap in technology and being involved in the community and working towards changing the current narrative and landscape in industry and academia, I think I'll always be involved in working towards bringing opportunities to younger girls in STEM and hosting panels, working, like creating workshops, something that I'm really passionate about, like creating education opportunities and space for more women in STEM. So that's something that'll always be a part of my life looking to the future. And a second part of that would be, bringing social good through technology is something else I'm really passionate about. So currently I am enrolled in a BSMS program at Georgia Tech. And after I do that, I want to work towards something that makes an impact to the world in a good way, whether that be in healthcare, like creating tools that creates a better life for other people. And going into like health tech. So that's really where I see my future going, working towards bringing some sort of good in the health tech space for members. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, Sarah, what about you?
So I kind of touched on it earlier, but I can go a little bit more in depth. So, I really hope that it's kind of like a 15-year goal down the line. Like it's definitely not yet, but that I will be able to be involved with creating the tools that make education specifically for children with learning differences in public school settings more accessible. I'm really, really passionate about that. Not even just learning differences, but I come from Framingham, Massachusetts. We have a large population of Brazilian immigrants and a large population of ESL students. And that is a very difficult thing for the school to deal with when you have so many kids coming to the school and they don't speak English yet. I want to be involved in, you know, studying how we can acquire language better and creating the tools to make it more accessible. So not just with learning differences, but with, you know, ESL students too. And that can grow into more than just kids. It can be, you know, if you want to learn a language really quickly, this is how you can do it. So, but that's really far down the line, but I really hope that I'll be able to do at least something in that sphere.
I definitely see your passion and I feel very optimistic that you will be doing that. Meghan, what about you? Do you want to go next?
Sure. So as I said, I'm now an entry-level employee at Bank of America, part of the Technology Analyst Program. But I haven't had a chance to actually, you know, give out my elevator pitch yet to anybody at a networking event. But I know that the line along the lines of something like, I'm a software developer at the moment for now is part of it. I know I want to explore different roles and careers in technology that are like outside of being an individual contributor. So I really don't know what the future holds. You know, I mentioned on my intro slide, I'm really not sure why I got the AIC award to start. There's a lot of smaller things that I did because I know I do want to do. So I did a little bit of everything. And that's still really true for me. You know, I can meet someone and I can want their job immediately. I like my job currently. I'm still learning, of course. But I think there's a lot of value in exploring things. And I feel like, you know, hopefully when my career continues and I have a long career, I can try different things and find out what brings me the most happiness and joy, and also like the most like technical challenges and stuff like that. So
thank you. I like that transparent answer of I don't know, and that makes total sense. Valencia, if you want to round us out.
Sure. I am also entry level at my current job as a gameplay engineer, but I know I want to somehow in the future of my career is to give back to the community by education. The whole reason I'm getting my master's is that I can be a professor one day. So one day I can go back and teach. and I can go back and show people that, hey, look, I've got a degree in gaming and I'm teaching gaming. That's something that's A, very rare to find where I'm from, and it's very rare to find someone, a woman of color, binary, genderqueer, anything doing that as a professor. So I think just being there and being in that presence and that I can be a role model to someone is what I really want to do in my career.
Thank you. And I just want to echo what my colleague from the NCWIT Higher Ed Alliance said. These responses are so inspiring, and we really, really appreciate you all for sharing. We're going to round robin really quick and just say, what's the one last thing you want, the last thing you want to say on this webinar? It could be completely related. It could be completely off topic. It could be the sky is blue. And I'm going to start with you, Alan.
I've got two things. One is the my other panelists here, absolute rock stars. And I think all of you have a brighter future than you think that you do. Sarah, you said that you had a 15-year journey to get to where you're going. I think you can do it in 5. You could do it.
I think it's more unlikely in 5. I appreciate the encouragement.
The other part is a slightly more sort of direct plea. We're always looking for aspirations reviewers, especially for the high school. We're just always looking for it. And it's a great thing to spend time with. And so if there are faculty members, if there's folks at the collegiate level here as well that are really interested in doing some reviews for the high schools, I strongly, strongly recommend that you take a look at the sort of the reviewer portal through aspirations.org. Please come help us.
Yes, we literally get, and this is literally 10,000 applications a year, 10,000 plus. So please come review. We have reviewer parties. We have, you know, prizes. There's a lot of fun in that process. Next, again, just really, really quick, 30 seconds or less. We have 2 minutes. Valencia, go ahead.
I just want to shout out, no matter what your specialty in computing is, you can do it. You can build your way. There's a group for you. There is a community for you. Especially this community. There is someone out there for you. You are not alone, because I felt like I was alone with my niche thing in gaming, but I found out I wasn't. So you are not alone as well.
Thank you. Vonesha?
I would just say that no matter what challenges come ahead, you have a huge community here who's here to advocate for you and support you. So keep like going for your dreams, and you're the innovators, you're all the problem solvers and the trailblazers of tomorrow. So this community is something that you can really lean back on and find opportunities in. And you're more than capable of making whatever impact that you want to make here.
Thank you. Meghan.
So I got my degree in the mail my first day of work in office, which was such an emotional day. I literally broke down crying. So what I will say to you is that you can absolutely get the degree you want. Please persist. I cannot wait for you all to get your first job, to get your first internship, your first research experience. Like, there are so many women who are waiting for you to come join us wherever we are in our tech journeys. So please keep going, find people who will support you, because we're absolutely here waiting.
And Sarah.
Really quickly, if you are ever scared to do anything, like I, a year ago, would not have done this, being on this panel today. Someone told me it's always going to feel scary. So just, you know, try everything. Listen to that. Okay. Like, I'm going to Tapia conference later this month or in September. I would not have done that because I would have been like, oh, it's too scary. It's too scary to go. It will always feel scary. So you shouldn't let that stop you from doing what you actually want to do.
Thank you. Thank you all so much for joining us. To our panelists, thank you so much for giving us your time and your energy and your expertise. We will share the recording from today's call. And as I mentioned, there is another series coming up, Computer Science Plus, where we explore the unique intersections between computer science and basically every industry imaginable. So thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Please complete the evaluation and let us know how we did.